Hello, and welcome to this short video on tips and tricks for using search and sharing in Windows Store applications. In this video, we'll have a look at some of the changes with how search works with Windows 8.1 and how we can implement that experience with our applications. We'll also have a look at implementing the search keyword suggestion and what result suggestions are and how it's helpful. And then we'll have a look at how we can win as one with the Windows platform by making use of the share charm. I have Windows 8.1 installed on my box, but here's a screenshot of how the search experience used to be with Windows 8. With Windows 8, you could go to your desktop on the start menu or the start screen and start typing in a keyword, and a search pane would show up on the right hand side, as you can see in the screenshot. You could also use the search charm from the right hand side or use the shortcut Windows Q, and you'd get the search pane. Now, when you start typing in your search keywords, by default, there are three places where your search keywords would be searched for. It starts with applications, and then you have settings, and then files. Just to highlight that, these are the three sections I'm talking about. So you have apps, settings, and files. Now, apart from this, when you have a search keyword keyed in, you could also choose from one of the applications which are listed over here. It then becomes the application's responsibility to deal with the search keyword. It could search on the web, it could search on its local data store, and then provide a page with the results of the search for that particular keyword. Nothing's changed with Windows 8.1, so let's have a quick look at what actually changed here. So I'm here on my desktop now, on this start screen, and I can start searching for some keyword. Let's start with consultant jargon, which is an application that's installed over here. So I'm just going to search for consultant, and you can see that as I search, notice that it says search, and it gives us an option: search everywhere, search in settings, or files, or web images, or web videos. Now these are all the different places that we can search from. Now apart from that, it also provides a few results, right? Now I'm going to talk about what results are versus what suggestions are. The three options that you see on the top, these are search result suggestions, and the ones that you see over here at the bottom are the search keyword suggestions. Now, when do we use which of these? When you're confident about the result. For example, I search for consultant jargon and I'm pretty confident that there is an application installed on my machine with that name. Windows 8.1 suggests that as a result. So when I press enter, it actually opens up the application itself. Now, let me close that and I'll come back and start searching for consultant jargon again. And notice that as I search, if it is CONSU, there are a few other options. As it becomes more specific, the result, the probability of the result being one of the suggested ones becomes higher. So we have a strong probability of this result being what the user is looking for. Now, if I don't want to tap on that, I can still click on the search button over here, and it would take me to the global search experience, which means it searches for consultant jargon on the web, and it also understands that consultant jargon is an application on the store. So if you click or tap on the suggestion on the left-hand side, it will again launch the application, as you can see over here. If you come back, it has a suggestion from Windows Store. So you can tap on this, and it'll take me to the Windows Store and take me to the page which is related to the application, which is the listing of the application. So this is the generic search experience. So it's not the same as in Windows 8. Some things have changed. So let's try and understand what is the recommendation, what is the recommended practice for us to implement search in Windows 8.1. So the search experience changed with Windows 8.1. Let's try and understand very quickly why this change was brought about. Notice here that searching within an application can be a little confusing. You know, when you used to open an application in Windows 8 and you had to search for something, you would have to bring up the search jar from the right-hand side, get to the search pane, and then search within the application. Although it was very powerful in terms of giving the ability for the user to key in a search keyword at one place and being able to search it in any application that allows the search feature, it used to be a little confusing for a lot of users in terms of discoverability. If they wanted to search something, the search feature wasn't available right there on the canvas. So that caused a little bit of confusion. So based on the usage statistics, the Windows team decided that, okay, I think there is a better way for search to be a little more intuitive, and that is to let the developers have a search box on the canvas itself. So whenever the user wants to search something, he or she has the search box right there on the top or at the bottom, depending on how you'd like to design your application. But the search box is right there on the canvas, and they can search very quickly. So let's have a quick look at a simple demonstration for using this control called search box, which was introduced with Windows 8.1. For demonstrating how we use the search box, I'm going to use a sample from MSDN. So you can search for search contract sample on the Windows Dev Center, or you could just go to Bing, type in search contract sample, Windows Store, and you'll get this page. So I'm going to use the C# version, which is available over here, and we're going to use that for the demonstration to understand how we use the search box. So this is the solution. Before getting into the details of the code, let's have a quick look at the sample itself. So there are a few scenarios that's implemented in the search control. In the interest of time, we are going to walk through just a couple of these, but the concept should be clear with these. To start with, there is a search box over here. I can click on that, and since I've searched a couple of times beforehand, it shows the frequently searched items. Now, if I type in, say, B, it shows a few cities which has a name starting with B. If I try with H, it has a few cities, which are all suggestions based on what I'm typing. Right? So I can say HO, and then it starts narrowing down to specific search suggestions. But notice that these are still search suggestions. These are not results. So I can select on this. It goes ahead, searches, and it gets the output back as well, which is good. But one of the feedback that we got from the forums and community was implementing the result suggestion was not very easy, and there wasn't a clear documentation of that. So let's have a look at that. So how does that work? Let me open up the Windows Store. And when I'm searching for apps, notice that there's a search box over here. I click on this and say I want to search for Temple. You have documents and templates, you have Temple running. Let's say I want to search for where, right? And it gives me some strong suggestions, which are results which people have been searching for. So when I type in WHE, it gives me a few suggestions for search, but it also gives me these results. And this part is what we got the feedback about, that we'd like to know how this works. So when I tap on this, right, it takes me to the page for Where's My Water. But if I type this and click on the suggestion, it'll search for it and give me the search results. So it's fundamentally different experiences. So let's go back to the desktop and have a look at what's happening here. So this is S1, which is scenario one, where we try to enter the name of a city in the text box and the search box, and we got a few suggestions. Now let's have a look at what the control actually looks like. So it's a different control. It's not a text box. It's a search box. It has a little search button over here, as you can see. And it can be kind of treated very similar to a text box in terms of how you style it, etc., etc. But there are a few interesting events that we hook up to. Right? There is the search box events suggestion requested, and there is the query submitted. So when there is a suggestion request, we handle it and we look up our specific source to come up with the suggestions. And that source over here is over here. It's basically a read-only array of strings with a lot of cities listed. And this is what I'm using as the source for my suggestion list. Let's scroll up. We have the search box suggestion requested event. So this is where we try to look up from our list to see if what the user is typing, if it's part of the list that I have, if it's relevant to my data store. So we get the query text from the event arguments. We do some basic check on that, and then we go ahead and look up the query string in the suggestion list. So for each string in the string array, we're going to try and look up if the query text is part of the string that we're examining. So once that happens, we can start appending suggestions or results. So let's start with appending query suggestions for this. So let's go ahead and search for, say, Seattle. So as soon as I typed in SE, it gives me a couple of search results. So I can select Seattle, Washington. So that is appending query suggestions, which are basically suggestion strings or suggestion keywords that can be used to further search and get the results. Now, the alternative is to append result suggestions. So the suggestion collection, which is over here, which is part of the application model.search namespace. You can use a suggestion collection, which you again get from the event arguments. And that suggestion collection is where we are adding either the query suggestions or result suggestions. So let me comment this out and uncomment the result suggestion. And if you look at the signature of this method, it expects the text followed by a detailed text, followed by a tag. And then if you have an image, it expects an iRandom access stream reference and then an alternate text in case the image doesn't exist. So I am just passing in the suggestion, which has the string starting from the query text that the user is typing in. The detail is a static text in this case. It's a capital of a famous country. And then the tag is something interesting. I have the suggestion and an environment.newline and then just a description saying that it's a popular tourist spot. Great. Why is this important? Let's have a look at this. So when you tap on this result suggestion, we noticed that there were fundamentally different behaviors. So if I were to go back to the Windows Store and search for one of these applications, notice that when I tap on the result suggestion, it takes me to the page directly. So it's a different experience than tapping on the suggestion, the keyword suggestion. So where do I get the details of what I should do when the user taps on the result? That is available through the tag parameter that this method expects. Notice that after the detail text, it has a string tag. That is where we're passing these details. So when I run this, now if I try to search for B, you'd see that now it shows up result suggestions. I can tap on this and it says Bangalore, which is a popular tourist spot. Close. So now let's go back to the application over here, the code, and let's have a look at what's happening. So I appended the search result suggestion and I also got the tag, but where am I subscribing for that event? In the constructor of this page, I'm looking up the search box suggestion, which is a search box in XAML, which is on the screen. There is an event called result suggestion chosen. We've subscribed to that, and in that event handler, we're just showing up a message dialog in this case, but we can go further and show the page which is relevant to the user in this case. So that was about search. Now let's have a look at sharing data using the share TAM. Our applications can be either a share source or a share target or both. Now, implementing a share source in our application is comparatively easier. You just define the data type and then you share the data. The data type could be text, an image, HTML content, custom data formats, it could be a file, it could be an image. So you define the data type and then share the data that needs to be shared with other applications. And this is fairly simple to do. For an application to be a shared target, it has to meet a few criteria. One, it has to declare that it is a shared target in the application's package manifest. It then has to handle the on shared target activated event in the application. It also has to understand or deal with one or more of the data types that it expects to be shared. So let's have a look at a quick demo on sharing data. Again, for demonstrating share source and share target, I'm going to use the samples of MSDN. So you can search for sharing source or share target and you should get these samples. So I'm going to use the C# portion of this. We have the share and source and target samples over here. It becomes easier for you to follow the samples along with the videos if we use the same thing. So we're going to use the same sample that's available out there on the web. So let's have a look at a simple scenario of sharing text. So we have the data package title, description, and the text that we'd like to share. You can either tap on the button over here for share, or you could bring up the charms bar, tap on share, choose an application, and it'll share the data with the title and, you know, the text that we wanted to share. Another example would be a share image, perhaps. Tap on select image and choose one of my pictures and tap on share. Select mail and you have the file attached and also a thumbnail attached as the data package that we are sharing. So let's have a look at the code and understand how this works. So I have the share text.xaml.cs open, and if you notice this, it's not a layout aware page. It derives from a class called share page. And this is specific to this particular sample. If you go to the definition of share page, you'll see that it derives from layout aware page and it's been implemented as an abstract class, basically because the basics of how share works remains the same, whether we are sharing an image or an HTML snippet or plain text or files or whatever, right? So how does that work? Notice that we have a class called Data Transfer Manager. And this class is the basic concept of how sharing works in Windows 8 and 8.1. So we use the data transfer manager and call a static method on that, which is get for current view, which gets an instance of the data transfer manager, which we're going to use further on. So when this page is navigated to, we go ahead and get an instance of data transfer manager. And we subscribe to the data requested event and hook that up to an event handler, which is on data requested. If you go to the definition of this, you'll see that we check if we can get the share content from the event arguments. We'll check if it's null. You can kind of do a little health check to see if you know, the conditions for sharing are met. In this case, we are checking if the title is null or empty, and once this is done, we're good to share. So when we have the get share content over here, that is implemented as if I scroll down over here and see that it's just declared as an abstract method which needs to be implemented. So we're going to implement that over here by overriding it. And if you look at what we're doing, we are basically getting the data request, checking if it's null or empty, and then we're actually setting the data that needs to be shared. We're going to use this common approach for sharing image, for example. So if I go to the code behind over here, you'll notice that we're going to set the title, description, etc. But for the image, we're going to refer to the image file that we got from the file picker and then use that as the item that needs to be shared, which is a list of iStorage items. And we're going to set the storage item for the requested data to the list of items. And then we're going to use the iStream reference create from the selected file, and finally call the set bitmap method on this. Similarly for HTML or any other data types, you'd see that the overall flow would be very similar. So that was about share source. It's fairly simple and you don't need to have any kind of declaration, etc. In this case, one of the scenarios is to share a deep link and that needs protocol support. But apart from that, for just sharing data, you don't need to have any kind of declarations in place. Let's have a look at share target. And this is slightly different. Let's run the app first. So when you run the app, this is what you see. You have a simple static page which says this demonstrates on how we receive content. And to try this out, we can basically open any other application and choose this application as the share target. So let's close this. Let's go to start. Let's go to consultant jargon. We generate some random jargon and bring up the share charm and tap on mail. It does this. So what actually happens when I tap on mail is it shares a title and some text, which is the body of it, and that is being handled by the mail application. Now if I select the share target C# sample, you'll see that this handles it differently. So it says this app was not activated through a quick link. The title is consultant jargon. The description is your genuine excuse for the day. The package family name is this. There are no web links. This is the logo. And this is the text that was shared. Let's close this. And let's go to Internet Explorer. Here's Bing. So I'm going to select, say, a portion of the page. Again, invoke the share and tap on the share target C# sample. And notice that in this case, it says the title is Microsoft Gears of War Bing, which is the title of the page. This is the web link. The data package content is this, and it understands that it is HTML. So the HTML version of that is this. Right? It includes a hyperlink. So it really depends on your application to handle what happens when the sharing is done. So let's try and understand how this works. The first thing is that you have to open up your package.apex manifest file, and you'll have to select one of these declarations. So you go to the declarations tab and you select that this is going to be a share target. So once this is a share target, you can start adding data formats that this application can handle. Over here, you can see a bunch of formats that this can handle. So that is step one. Next, you go to your app.xaml.cs and you handle the onShare target activated event. Now there are a few different ways that your application can be launched. Right? One is when you tap on the tile on your start screen. Second is through some sort of a protocol. For example, the Skype application for Windows Store. If you have Skype running in the background and if there is a call coming in, it would automatically invoke that application. Similarly, when you choose an application as a share target, that is another way of activating the application. So in this case, notice that on launched, which is, you know, I search for the app, tap on that, tap on the tile, the application launches. That is one way of launching this app. And in that case, we're navigating to the default page, which shows that static page that we saw. And then we also have on share target activated. So in this case, we're going to the main page, and the main page handles the incoming data. So let's go all the way up. So on navigated to, what we're doing is getting the share operation from the event arguments. And from there, we're trying to get the description, package family name, and a bunch of other things which we saw in the application. And then we start to handle each of the data types, be it a web link, an application link, text, storage items, and so on. So implementing a share target is a little more involved than implementing a share source. But if your application is something like a mail client, or if it's something like a Twitter client and so on, you would want data to be shared with your application and not just from your application. So this becomes pretty important. So to recap, we're going to have to keep these three points in mind. One, declare that your application is a share target. Second, handle the on share target activated event, and then deal with the data that's coming in. I thank you for your time. Hope you enjoyed today's presentation, and hope you have a nice day.